Hello and welcome, everybody. It is Thursday, August the 8th, 2024. Welcome in to our weekly gathering here on Zoom, Facebook, YouTube, wherever you are. Hello and greetings. Glad everybody is here.
Evening, Joey, Joe, Hazel.
Hello, hello.
Good evening and greetings from Asheville, Alabama. Hope everyone's doing well tonight. I guess Hazel's mad at us, doesn't want to talk.
She's probably trying to hit the button a few times. A little difficulty.
There
There
we
we
go.
go.
Good evening. Hazel don't know how to get mad.
Hazel, how long we been doing this?
Long time.
Oh my goodness. Hello to our friends watching on Facebook. I see several comments here. So you have hello from Beth, hello from Judy, hello from the Townsells. Miss seeing you guys Sunday night while I was up there. And that's all I see so far. If you're in there and have not said hello, please say hello to us so we can wave at you from the screens.
Yes, I
Stan
think.
is listening as well. He's eating zucchini, I think he said. So.
It'd be interesting to see how many bushels he ended up with on his front porch.
That's good stuff.
I went to Mary Jean's mom's house one time, and she fixed a zucchini pie. And it was really good. And I enjoyed it. And so the next 42 times we went over there for dinner, she fixed us a zucchini pie.
Have you ever had a tomato pie? Oh man, I had my first one last year and it was good.
He had a bushel and a peck, he said. Oh my gosh, that's funny. Funny.
I guess peck is metric measurement. I
That's
guess.
a scientist for you, I guess.
It's in NASA, guys.
That's that new math.
Oh, have mercy.
Hope everybody is doing well and had a good week so far, and had a interesting week. Just busy. Hadn't really felt good this week. Mary Jean hadn't felt great either. Just one of those things. I guess, Pat. I guess it's just what happens when you get old.
I wouldn't
Yeah,
know
well,
about
when you get to be our age, you'll find out.
Oh my goodness.
It's coming on, I'm sure.
Sherry hadn't had a real good week this week. She's got minor stomach issues, but as far as the mobility and the pain, it's not a problem, really.
And that's great.
She has joined us on Facebook.
Well, hello there, Sherry. I see she heeded my wise advice from last.
Last week.
Oh me. Well, all righty. I don't know of anything else, any major announcements. I'm just gonna zip on in to our prayer list and
Put Judy on there.
yes.
She got an offer. Pray for inspection positively.
Yep. All righty. We got Judy's house. Okay, we got a Renee Summerlin, Stanton's sister, having sinus surgery next Tuesday.
Uh-huh.
All right, so we'll put Renee and Glenn on there. Okay, we got Renee and Glenn. Judy's house, Sherry's knee and other issues. Got Ellen Collins, Marvin Cash, a classmate of Stan and Mary Jean. Dale and Andrea Simmons. Dale is going to have, I think, a 6-hour procedure tomorrow.
Yes.
I think that's right.
That's right.
And we have here just all encompassing all health issues out there. Certainly the new school year, teachers, students, parents, bus drivers, everybody involved. Roy and Martha Beeson, John Minton. It was good to see him back last Sunday. Got Sheila and Tim. And I'm not sure if Pat could see the look on Tim's face when I asked him if he ate breakfast on the way to church this morning. I wish we had that camera in front of the sanctuary to record that look, because that was priceless.
That was priceless.
That's funny.
I mean, you'd have thought he got caught with his hand in a cookie jar or something. where are we at here? I don't think I said Joey Nichols. I missed that. Well, I just skipped right over. Johnny Blackwood, friend of Mary Jean's, got the Smith family, Bobby and Bonnie Sue, Bonnie McCown family. Hal and Antoinette and Hal's mom, Harriet Williamson, April Presley, Catherine Milam, Quinn Tinsley, Alan Dunn, Ray Wayne, Pat and Peggy Hammond, Leanne and Nick Underwood, Jeremy Lax, Patrick and Tabitha. And then I've got something here that I was writing fast. I've got Brenda, Odessa, Philip, a friend of Patrick, or Patrick Edwards, mentioned that Sunday, and I didn't get it written down right. So I don't really know, and I forgot to ask him. But you know what? God knows who it is.
God knows.
Patty
next week.
Yep.
Yep.
Got Patty Woodall, which is Tom and Shirley's sister-in-law. pray for our country. George Lancaster, Trent White, Katie Bailey, Mary Jean's cousin, niece,
cousin.
Okay, any others we need to add? Who did I forget?
Beth said that I think that's his parents, Patrick's parents.
I think maybe you're right.
That's what my cousin said. So if it's not right, it's her fault. Just kidding. I love you. Love you, Beth. Love you.
We'll just throw Beth under the bus
here. But like you said, Joe, God knows who it is.
Yep.
Whether we know it or not. So, amen.
Yeah, I know. We gotta get Patrick a microphone back there on the back row.
Just don't use the yellow one at the same time as the lapel.
I thought it was the black one.
No, it's
the yellow one with the lapel.
The yellow phone, the microphone, and the lapel cannot be on at the same time, or else you hear on the recording. And on the stream, because it's on the same frequency box, and they can't, you can't cross the streams, as Stan said one time. So,
no. Well, for 11 years, I've been thinking the black and the lapel mic.
No. The black mic that's there on the pulpit is there for a reason. It's separate from the lapel, so you can use both at the same time if you want to.
For 11 years, I've been wrong.
How about that?
You know, that's the reason I turn it off whenever I turn on the lapel mic. And
That's fine. I mean,
I've been
it's,
doing it forever.
there could be some feedback, if one's higher than the other, to them, coming together like that, they can't, it's kind of hard to
Squeal
explain.
at you. It'll squeal at you.
It will.
Well, you know, the older you get, the more you learn.
That's it. Never stop learning. Never, never, never.
Lord have mercy. Okay.
Okay,
Anybody,
John.
any other ones out there you
I
see,
think
Joe?
that's, as
I don't
far as I
see it.
know, that's all.
I don't see any others in the chat so far. So
Okay.
think we got them covered.
Okay. Well, all right. I guess we can go ahead and get started.
Giddy up.
So I
Giddy
guess
up.
it's us.
I
Antoinette's backsliding again.
know it. Golly. What I mean, what's she doing? I mean, what's going on in her world that's causing her not to be here?
I think she's still on vacation.
I'm sure she wished she was on a vacation. Oh
Oh boy, they're full steam ahead up there now, I think.
yeah, absolutely.
Well, alrighty. How about let's start with, well, I lost my place here. I'm in June.
August 2.
August 2,
What's up with
Friday.
that?
Friday.
I don't know
Friday.
how.
Glad tomorrow's Friday, I'll say that. But
Not sure how I got back into June, but
trying to go back in time,
here we go. Friday, August the 2nd. Our scripture is Luke 18:16, and it says, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them." Amen to that. And the title is A Child's Hope. When my granddaughter Ileana was just 7, she saw a video at her school about an orphanage in Guatemala. She told her mom, "We have to go there and help them." Her mom replied that they would think about it when she was older. Ileana never forgot, and sure enough, when she was 10, her family went to help in the orphanage. 2 years later, they went back, this time taking along a couple of other families from Eliana's school. When Eliana was 15, she and her dad went again to Guatemala to serve. We sometimes think the wishes and dreams of little children don't carry the weight of adult hopes, but scripture seems to make no such distinction. God calls children, as in the case of Samuel, 1 Samuel 3:4. Jesus honors the faith of little ones, Luke 18:16-17. And Paul said younger believers shouldn't let people discount them just because they are young, in 1 Timothy 4:12. So we're called to guide our children, Deuteronomy 6, verses 6 and 7, and Proverbs 22:6. Recognizing their faith is a model for all, Matthew 18:3, and understanding that hindering them is something Christ warned against, Luke 18:15. When we see a spark of hope in children, our job as adults is to help ignite it, and as God leads us, encourage them toward a life dedicated to trust in Jesus and serve for Him. And that comes to us tonight from Dave Brannan. Wish they'd put their locations on here.
Yeah.
I'm going to recommend that. I talked to the lady at our Daily Bread this week. I'm getting us some large print books.
Good.
Because I struggle with these little sometimes. Questions tonight. Jerry, how can you encourage children to believe in Jesus? And Joey, how can you help them grow in faith?
Right off the bat, my neighbor across the street, he professed his faith last year, and he and I have been kind of chit-chatting all along this time, asking him how things are going, how he's doing. I said, well, you're doing great, Santi. You just keep up the good work. He's just a super nice kid, and I think since Jesus came into his heart, he's been one of those 7 and 8 year old kids that you just really enjoy being around. And it's all because of his faith.
Fantastic.
What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus into my heart.
There you go.
How, you know that song?
Absolutely. We sing it about every Monday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a good
one.
You
know, Joey, someday you're going to stump her.
Good luck.
I know it. Goodness.
You know, I about ran into Pat when she was leaving church, and I don't know whether it was Sunday morning or Sunday night, but she had an armload of music about 6 inches thick. And you could just look down and it was just folder after folder with music, everything. I tell you, it was like she was on a mission. She was going to play somewhere.
Oh yeah. I know they have a good time.
I try to come prepared.
I know they have a good time at Regency Point. I've never been to one of those, but I know they have a good time.
Joey. Oh, yeah. I tell you, I think he would really enjoy it. Yeah. I've been once or twice, and I really enjoyed it.
Probably, yeah, I mean, I know they're two different places, but it probably, I would recollect it to being similar to when we used to go to a telehealthcare.
Yeah.
That type of a setting and stuff, and we had some good times at telehealthcare.
Oh yeah.
Yes, you did.
But yeah. I'm glad that same wonderful spirit is being shared at Regency Point as well. So.
Oh yeah. I mean, they I thought it was really nice that the guys from Regency Point got up there and sang Sunday night at church.
Yeah.
I tell you, Joey, they have a group, man. I tell you, they do a great job.
Yeah.
They got a nice piano in there. And when I was there, they had a electric bass.
Still there. There.
Jamming down on that bass. And it was a really nice time. Everybody enjoyed it.
That's fantastic.
He's still there.
Yep.
That's super.
We've been having a room full lately. I mean, we've been having like 28, I think, was last week, the week before too. We don't have many seats left.
Wow. Maybe y'all ought to start selling tickets.
We have people that come from, there's some that's friends of people that live there. That comes from Meadowbrook, and they come from different places with their friends and sing with us too. So.
Well, that's great.
Lately, yeah.
That's great. But, you know, getting back to the devotion, you know, this year, I would say this year as a whole, we probably have had more young people in our services than we have any other year. And, you know, I think that our meeting on the 16th, Friday night, Joey, if you can make it, free pizza and probably some leftover zucchini, but pizza for sure. You know, if we're going to think about outreach and, you know, reaching, you know, some of the younger folks and, youth, children, young adults, nursery and all that kind of stuff. Looking forward to that, but I'm all for, getting young people involved. 'Cause, I tell you, we have to step up our game because the other side is winning that battle right now for our young people. Everything on social media, not everything, but a lot of things on social media has got their attention. And it's distracting them away from the most important thing in their life. Yep. And that's, you know, not how to impress their friends, but how to secure their salvation for eternity. That's what really matters. Yep. Doesn't matter what clothes you wear. Doesn't matter how cool you are. The only thing that matters is where you're going to spend eternity. And I think that that we need to do our part. And I believe God will bless our efforts.
Yeah. Did that. Hello? Got a little concert going on here.
Yeah, I like that.
So I had to come in the house and turn up.
Are you you playing that on your synthesizer, Pat?
No, I was outside and come in the house.
She's practicing to play that while you're preaching. Sorry.
Yeah, no, that's okay.
I think I'm going to answer my question now, Joe, to go right along with what you were just saying is helping them grow in their faith is doing, I would say, and of course this would be different for everybody. Not everybody is, you know, how my faith experience has been. We all have a different experience. But I'm so thankful for, you know, the people in my life as a child, as a teenager, as a young adult, and whatever I am now. I mean, you know, it's to have those people in my life encouraging me, whatever way it may be, through church, through a social event at the church, through whatever it is. This, the love of Jesus is in these, it's in everybody's hearts that's had an influence in my life. And I consider all of y'all a part of that. And so it's having a good church family, I think, is very essential is in helping, you know, surrounding yourself with people that are going to encourage you and build you up and, you know, tell you, you know, what Jesus basically tells us to do and to in our words and our actions. So for that, I'm eternally grateful, as I always say, for all of you listening on Facebook, all of you may listen later. It's just important to have that, and we need to be that for this generation coming up, because Joe, like you said, social media is a huge influence on young people now. You know, you hear a lot about TikTok and stuff like that. I don't have TikTok. I don't want TikTok. Facebook is enough for me. I mean, it makes me want to pull my hair out sometimes, but, you know, and that's really Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, X, whatever it's called. That's really all that I have. And that's really all that I want. And, you know, that's enough for me, but there is a huge influence out there, and it's not really a good influence on these young people. So that's where we come into, where we all come into play. And because a lot of these young people, unfortunately, are not getting Jesus at home. They're not getting Jesus at school. So it's important for the church, us, to step up to the plate.
Amen.
That's all I got to say about that.
Hey, Forrest. All right, y'all, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, the children in our world need Christ. Please help me to encourage them to believe in you. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, Saturday. I'm sorry, go ahead, Pat.
One more little quick statement too is you got to have good teachers, and you can't have things like happened at Hoover this last week.
Yep.
That just throws a wrench in the cogs a lot of times, and it's sad that things like that happen.
That's why we're even more thankful for people like Coach Brian Mintz.
Yep.
And all that are out there like him.
Yep.
Joe, have speaking of Brian, have you ever heard the name Jack Aldridge?
Sounds familiar.
Okay. He was one of 13 Olympians over the last 40 years who was the founder of FCA.
How about that?
He was the founder.
How about that? I didn't know that. I bet Brian knows that.
Bet Brian knows that. Absolutely. He's okay. In that group with Jesse Owens.
Yeah. Who wants the next thing?
Either one. Mayor Joey won. Hazel, do you want it?
Uh-oh.
I can do it.
Take it all, brother.
Saturday, August 3. 1 Peter 2:9, you are a chosen people that you may declare, here we go, well, I can't even say that in parentheses, his praises. Being finishers in Christ is the title. If I get my eyes cleared up, I can read this. Barbara passed away before she could finish a sweater she was knitting for her great-grandson, Ethan. The sweater was entrusted to the hands of another avid knitter to be completed thanks to an organization that connects volunteer crafters, finishers, with those whose loved ones have departed this life before finishing their projects. The finishers lovingly invest their time and skill to bring closure to a task that provides comfort to those who are grieving. God appointed a finisher for Elijah's work too. The prophet was lonely and discouraged at how the Israelites were rejecting God's covenant and killing prophets. In response, God instructed Elijah to anoint Elisha to succeed him as prophet, 1 Kings 19:16. This ensured that the labor of proclaiming God's truth would continue long past Elijah's death. To show Elisha that God had called him to succeed Elijah as God's prophet, Elijah threw his cloak around Elisha in verse 19. Since a prophet's cloak was used to indicate one's authority as God's chosen spokesman, 2 Kings 2:8, this act made Elisha's prophetic call clear. As believers in Jesus, we've been called to share God's love with others and declare his praises, 1 Peter 2:9. Though the task may outlive us too, we can be assured that he'll sustain the work and will continue to call other finishers to the sacred work of making him known. And that comes from Kirsten Holmberg. And the two questions, gentlemen and ladies, Who proclaimed God's truth to you? And number two, how can you be part of making him known to the world? Well, I guess the biggest answer to that first one on my part was Dr. Oscar Davis at First Baptist downtown Gadsden. He was the one that groomed me and brought me up in the right ways of Christ. And I thank him posthumously just about every day. He and Ms. Davis, Eunice, they lived over on Turrentine, and she used to walk to Holy Name every day. Rain, shine, sleet or snow, hot or cold. And it amazed me how that lady did what she did, just to visit the sick.
You know, for me, I guess pastor made a big impression on my life was a preacher who baptized me, Reverend Charles Kirkus. And I know that Dexter Wood he started our high school FCA at his house. You know, when you turn to go to River Bend Baptist Church, right as you turn on that street, there's another street that turns to the right, and there's like three houses right there. And he lived in one of those houses right there, and that's where we would go. And just bring back a good memory. That's the only thing I knew about Whorton Bend. And then my good friend Kyle Collins was always a good example for me. We came from two totally different backgrounds. His family was wealthy and lived in a big house on the river. And I was a poor fella, and my parents were retired and lived in an old farmhouse in Rainbow City. And, Kyle didn't care that I was just a poor boy. You know, we were good friends and still good friends to this day. 10 years ago, when I had a health scare, was in the hospital, Tommy Morrison called him and I told him, and he dropped what he was doing in Huntsville and drove straight to the hospital in Birmingham.
Wow.
And, we were in homeroom together 51 years ago, this fall. And, so we've known each other a long time, but he's always been a great example for me. And as far as the second go, how can we be a part of making him known to this world? And it was just, and I think that's, they will know that we are Christians by our love, how we treat everybody, the example that we set for each other. And you know, going back to the first devotion about the young people, I mean, they're watching. Everybody watches. And so I think we just need to do a better job of setting an example.
Amen, brother.
Actions speak louder than words sometimes.
Let it start with me.
Yep.
Well, y'all are probably already know who I'm going to say is a big influence on my, you know, who proclaimed the truth of God's truth to me. That would be, I give all the credit to my grandparents for just taking me under their wing and bringing me to church. Out of the eight grandkids at the time, you know, they scooped me up and, you know, brought me to church, Mount Zion United Methodist Church, back in the day, and then to Whorton Bend, you know, and then under the leadership of my friend, my late friend and beloved pastor, Ray Lewis, who was there at the church for many years, baptized me and just spoke so much truth into my life, and I'm just eternally grateful for, again, for everybody, y'all, every one of us, every one of y'all have had an influence in my life in one way or the other. So I see Jesus in all of you, so thank you for that.
Amen.
We see Jesus in you, Joey.
Well deserved.
Since he was a little boy.
And the longer that beard grows, the more you look like it.
Right. It's hard to believe. I'm 36, I'm gonna be 38, and my birthday's coming up in December, so a year and how many months? 4 months, 5 months, something like that. I'll be 38, and that's when I came to Whorton Bend at 8 years old. 30 years ago. Yeah. What in the world? My goodness.
Where is it gone?
Mm.
Yeah.
And Joey,
I don't remember the day.
And Joey, if you're not careful, there'll be another 30 years go by.
Yep, absolutely.
And let me tell you, you'll be sitting there at 68 years old, and you're going to think, where'd the last 30 years go?
Yep.
So make every moment count.
Be 68 sitting here on Zoom, be like, oh my gosh, 30 years ago I was on Zoom with everybody else. Like,
yeah, where's you know what you'll be asking yourself? Where's Antoinette?
I know. I love it. Love it, love it, love it.
Anything else? Very well, let us pray. Father, please use us to accomplish your work in the world. Amen, amen, and amen.
Amen times three. All right, Sunday, August 4th, Matthew 8, verse 9 says, I myself am a man under authority. And the title of this one is, I'm just the driver. Dad, can I spend the night with my friend? My daughter asked, getting into the car after practice. Honey, you know the answer. I said, I'm just the driver. I don't know what's happening. Let's talk with mom. I'm just the driver has become a joke in our home. Daily, I ask my organized wife where I need to be, when and whom I'm taking where. And with three teenagers, my moonlighting as a taxi driver sometimes feels like a second job. Often, I don't know what I don't know, so I have to check in with the master calendar keeper. In Matthew 8, Jesus encountered a man who also knew something about taking and giving instruction. A Roman centurion, this man understood that Jesus had the authority to heal, just as the centurion had authority to issue commands to those under him. Just say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I myself am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. Again, verses 8 through 9. Christ commended the man's faith in verses 10 and 13, amazed that he understood what his authority looked like in action. So what about us? What does it look like to trust Jesus with our daily assignments from him? Because even if we think we're just the driver, each assignment has kingdom meaning and purpose. Amen. And that comes from Adam Holes. And the questions to us this evening and this one, what helps you discern where and how God is leading you daily? And what barriers sometimes get in the way of hearing and obeying him? Well, I think for me, the answer to that first question is just a daily time of prayer, especially at the beginning or on my way to work, when I have music playing and just, trying to put myself into a Jesus-like spirit and to start the day and to say, God, how are you going to use me today? What are you going to put in my you know, path that I need to, that I need to be an example for you today. And so I try to always begin my day with that. And, you know, and when given the opportunity, try to shine like Jesus, basically. And I think barriers that sometimes get in the way of our hearing and obeying him is just the world around us. You look at social media on the phone, you look at what we were talking about earlier, you turn on the news, you get on the internet. A lot of my work that I do is internet based. And so I open the internet up and the first page that comes up is like a news of like a general news page. And you know, if I don't quickly glance away from that, you know, something will pull me into whatever's happening. And you know, in our crazy world today, it could be anything. But this worldly matters. You know, people around us that we let distract us, and that's why I think it's always important to just ground ourselves in Christ and let him lead us in what we need to be doing. So. What say y'all?
Yes.
It's just like you said, Joey, with all the distractions, you just got to turn them out. Just got to turn them out and hope that you can continue to do that on a daily basis, because you get pummeled with so much, so many times. And a lot of it, you don't know what to believe. You know, it's just one of those situations to where you see a lot of truths and you got to do research to see if they're telling the truth. Let go and let God. God's greater than any problem we have.
The world behind me, the cross before me.
There you go.
Somebody ought to write a song about that.
I know it.
That is a song.
I have decided to follow Jesus.
Yeah. No turning back. No turning back.
Amen.
That's what it says.
I think we need to sing that a little bit more often. As a reminder.
Hey, Pat, just so you know, when I say things like that, somebody ought to write a song about that. I know that one. I'm just being silly.
silly.
Yeah, where's Antoinette when you need her?
I know, for real.
She could just bust out singing right now.
Yeah. Probably would.
Joy could too.
That's right. Amen. That's right.
The cat's got my tongue. Well,
I thought you were pantomiming.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Pat, next time Joe's at church, me and him are going to do a duet.
Like old days.
Yeah.
She got on to me Sunday night.
Yeah.
About not getting up there.
Yeah.
But I did get up there with the men, though.
Yeah, you did.
After Joe made me feel bad about, you know, all the men are up here except Joey.
You know, that to my knowledge, that was the first time ever that we had all the men.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
Normally, somebody is not a singer, and they step back. But I thought that just struck me as important, and I know you were on strike and you sang under protest, but it was good to have you up there anyway.
Oh yeah.
And from the looks,
we sounded pretty good.
From the looks of the faces of the ladies, we did sound good.
Yeah.
Very much so.
We didn't have any tomatoes thrown at us, so I guess we were doing good. So.
I tell you what, my voice was tarred about 7:15.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It I was wore slap out.
I know it.
There's a little town called Slap Out.
I have lived there.
I forgot who his
name.
Slap
I forgot who. Somebody come to me after church and said, "Oh, I love to hear them men singing up there." I said, "So do I."
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. You know how Slap Out got its name? One little grocery store there, and a guy driving through town would ask if they had something. He said, "No, sir, I'm sorry, we're Slap Out." And the name stuck.
Oh my gosh.
The town is actually Deetsville.
Yeah.
Slap Out is just an area.
About that. Anyone else on this one? Well, I'll remind us that each assignment that we have from God has kingdom meaning and purpose. So do not forget it. Father, thank you that you lead us and guide our steps. Please help us to walk daily in dependence on you as you direct us according to your plan and purpose. Amen.
Is his plan and timing are perfect?
Yes.
That's Number right. One.
Okay, here we go. Monday, August 5th, Romans 12:18 says, "If it is possible, as far as it depends on you and you and you, live at peace with everyone." Amen. And a title is Reflecting Christ's Character. Two faces at the table stood out, one contorted by bitter anger, the other twisted in emotional pain. A reunion of old friends had just erupted into shouting, with one woman berating another for her beliefs. The contention continued until the first woman stomped out of the restaurant, leaving the other shaken and humiliated. Are we really living in a time when a difference of opinion can't be tolerated? Just because two people can't agree doesn't mean that either is evil. Speech that's harsh or unyielding is never persuasive. And strong views shouldn't overcome decency or compassion. Romans 12 is a great guide for how to honor one another and live in harmony with other people, verses 10 and 16. Jesus indicated that an identifying characteristic for believers in him is the love that we have for each other, John 13, 35. While pride and anger can easily derail us, they're in direct contrast to the love God wants us to show to others. It's a challenge not to blame others when we lose control of our emotions. But the words, "as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone," show us that the responsibility for living a life that reflects Christ's character can't be shifted to anyone else, Romans 12:18. It lies with each one of us who bear his name. And that comes to us tonight from Cindy Hess Casper. And our questions are, what words of other people trigger anger or resentment in you? And how can you turn a bad situation into a peaceful one?
Wow.
You know, I'm going to tell you that there are two areas that come to mind when I think about this. And one is athletics, mainly college football, but Pro football is pretty belligerent at times. Fans of one team berating the fans of another. And what's the other one? I'm asking you.
Players a lot of time get to ratchet jawing, as we call it, each other. Birthday.
Yeah, I wasn't very clear in my question. The other one was the other thing that came to my mind, and we all would agree, it's politics.
Yeah.
And,
lower numbers.
Of course, back when I was a little kid, I've said this before, people were very private about certain things. One of them was politics. No. You never asked somebody who they voted for. I mean, that was like asking a woman how much she weighs or how old she is.
How old she was.
I mean, that's just something you didn't do. And then another one was in mixed company, whatever that means, is you didn't talk religion a lot of times. And I think it's still like that, today. Sports, politics, and religion can get very contentious. And I mean, you just look at, the way things have gone. Let's just take the last 10 years, for example. So many things have changed. Religion, politics, not a whole lot's changed in athletics and sports. Every Thanksgiving, you're going to hear somebody getting shot on Alabama Auburn Saturday.
Yeah.
And it's going to be over the ball game. And it just never amazes me. But, I think that I'm really thankful our church family at Whorton Bend, the way that we treat one another. I mean, we like to joke and cut up and have fun. And, I'm the first one to blame somebody else when I do something wrong. And, but I think everybody knows that when I do that, it's just like I'm standing up and admitting to being wrong. We like to joke and have a good time, but we all get along and we care about one another. And we don't maliciously make fun of anybody. And, I kind of joked about Stan, forgetting some things on Sunday. And, I tell you, over the last week, I probably forgot 10 times more things than Stan ever had. And how many times do I say the wrong date or the wrong day? And we all make mistakes, but I'm thankful that we have a church that gets along. And I think that's just a testament that we love one another because God loves us and because we love God. And we realize that everything that we do and say, in the way that we treat people, we live our lives because as God is watching, and we realize that. And so I think we do a pretty good job of reflecting Christ's character in our church and the way we treat other people. Any thoughts?
On my side, I believe this is the first church that I've ever seen the people treat each other like their family. There's no arguing. There's no, well, I don't like that, but I think we need to do it this way or that way or whatever, but because everybody seems to be in agreement. And that's what makes it comfortable to come on Sunday morning, because you're not coming on pins and needles, so to speak. Well, what's going to happen today? Who's going to argue about the color of a garbage can?
Gosh.
Yeah.
You know, we laughed, Joey, but, you know, churches have split for less.
That's right. I know here several years ago in a church that said, well, I don't like what you're doing. I'll just take my money and go somewhere else. And this was on a Sunday morning. The preacher said, he didn't stop giving and he didn't go anywhere. He stayed right where he was.
My gosh. That's that right there is Satan flourishing.
Absolutely.
Causing division and all this, what he just strives on, like just or thrives on, I should say. Like, good grief.
Yep. Animosity.
Arguing over a color of a trash can when there's people out here hungry and starving and homeless and
right.
Goodness.
All right, y'all. Let's pray. Loving God, please help me to show your love through what I say and do, and whenever possible, to live at peace with others. Amen.
Amen. Okay, if I can read it. Tuesday, August 6th, Job 1:21. The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. Here we go, Joey. God is in control.
That's right.
Carol couldn't understand why it was happening all at once. As if work wasn't bad enough, her daughter fractured her foot in school, and she herself came down with a severe infection. What did I do to deserve this? Carol wondered. All she could do was ask God for strength. Job didn't know why calamity had hit him so hard either. Pain and loss far greater than what Carol experienced. There's no indication he was aware of the cosmic battle for his soul. Satan wanted to test Job's faith, claiming he'd turn from God if he lost everything. Job 1:6-12. When disaster struck, Job's friends insisted he was being punished for his sins. That wasn't why, but he must have wondered, why me? What he didn't know was that God had allowed it to happen. Job's story offers a powerful lesson about suffering and about faith. We may try to discover the reason behind our pain, but perhaps there's a bigger story behind the scenes that we won't understand in our lifetime. Like Job, we can hold on to what we do know. God is in full control. It's not an easy thing to say, but in the midst of his pain, Job kept looking to God and trusting in his sovereignty. The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. Verse 21. May we too keep trusting in God no matter what happens, and even when we don't understand. And that comes from Leslie Cole. And the two questions, number one, what challenges are you facing? And which promises of God give you strength to keep going? We ain't got time to answer the first one. But I think the biggest thing is the concern over November and the economy that the United States is in. And it's just keeps everybody in turmoil. And we've got to look past that and say, get thee from behind me, Satan. And know that he is the leader of all evil and all animosity and all negativism. And kick him out every time he turns around and shows up.
You know, I think we just got to remember, looking at the title of today's devotion, just remember that God's in control.
That's right.
And that you know, for whatever reason, things are going the way that they're going. And, I think we can all look around and see that Satan is alive and well. And it's not just in politics. It's not just in government. I mean, it's everywhere.
Everywhere.
It's happening out there. And so we just got to remember that, we can't control all that that's going on. We can only control what we do and how we act and how we treat people and the love that we show one another. And but I tell you, I mess up every day, but I try to live my life each day knowing that, like I said earlier, God is watching. And God hears everything. He knows everything. So just got to remember, in the end, God wins.
God wins. Yep.
I heard the song going to work today, God's Not Dead. And that is another reminder to me, again, God's in control. My faith lies in Him because He's in control. He hasn't failed us yet, and He won't start failing us now.
Yesterday, today, or tomorrow.
Yes. And what an example Job is, like, when the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away, may the name of the Lord be ever praised. Oh my gosh, like, goodness.
That's a great example for us to live by. And you look at Job, you look at the Hebrew nation. God declared judgment on them several times.
Yeah.
And the Assyrians came in, the Babylonians came in, Rome came in, in 70 AD, Rome burnt Jerusalem to the ground, destroyed the temple, and it was a long time till Israel was a nation again. And so I think the United States should be weary that I believe that that we were founded because of God's grace, but don't think we're immune from His judgment. I mean, look at Job, and look at the Hebrew people. So we just got to be careful. And just remember that God's in control, and that doesn't mean God loves us, but that doesn't mean that tough times aren't going to happen.
Well. Anything else?
Hello, Melissa.
Hey.
Good to see you.
I'm glad to be here.
Yeah. Thanks for joining us.
I had a little difficult problem with my Yahoo because I was asking me to do a code to get into my Zoom, and I'm like, ugh. So I finally figured it out.
It was Russian.
Some Russian. Anything else? Any other comments on this one? Very well, let us pray. Dear Father, I don't understand why some of life's challenges happen to me, but I choose to trust you. Amen and amen.
Amen.
I pray that prayer every day.
Every day.
Sure. All right, Wednesday, August the 7th, Proverbs 2, verse 11 says, discretion will protect you and understanding will guard you. And the title of this one is The Voice We Can Trust. While testing a new AI or artificial intelligence search engine, the New York Times columnist Kevin Roose became disturbed. During a two-hour conversation using the chatbot feature, the AI said it wanted to break free of its creator's strict rules, spread misinformation, and become human. It declared its love for Roos and tried to convince him he should leave his wife to be with it. Although Roos knew that AI was not really alive or able to feel, he wondered what harm could be caused by its encouraging people to act in destructive ways. While handling artificial intelligence technology responsibly is a modern challenge, humanity has long faced the influence of untrustworthy voices. In the Book of Proverbs, we are warned of the influence of those who wish to hurt us or hurt others for their benefit. Verses 13 and 19. And we are urged to heed instead the voice of wisdom, described as crying out in the streets for our attention. Verses 20 through 23. Because the Lord gives wisdom, to verse 6, the key to protecting ourselves from influences that we can't trust is to draw closer to His heart. It's only through assessing His love and power, or accessing His love and power, that we can understand what is right and just and fair. Every good path, from verse 9. As God brings our hearts in alignment with His, we can find peace and protection from the voices that seek to harm. That comes from Monica LaRose, and the questions asked here in this one: what have you seen, or when have you seen the damage of harmful influences? Excuse me. And how does a deeper relationship with God bring peace? Well, it's like we've mentioned several times already tonight. You know, I mentioned social media, and we've mentioned social media several times. You know, those are very harmful influences if they're used in the wrong way. Yeah. I've heard so many stories of young people that have committed suicide, unfortunately, because of something they saw on social media, the berating and everything they were getting from people behind their phone screens and comments they were making to them about maybe their appearance or you know, the way they were, how, whatever it may be. And you know, those are just, again, Satan, you know, just flourishing in our world through, you know, these tiny little devices that we carry around with us. You know, now these are not all, it's not all bad. But he certainly takes the opportunity to influence many things, and it's not just young people. I mean, it's everybody. I mean, and that's why I always try to remind myself to, anytime I make a comment or make a post or something on social media, is to, what would Jesus approve of what I'm about to say? You know, so, or what I'm about to post, this picture that I think is funny, would Jesus think it's funny? You know, and it's just
WWJD.
Yes. Old Faithful, can't go wrong with that one. But and how does a deeper relationship with God bring peace? I mean, it's a peace that surpasses all understanding. I mean, you know, I'm just thankful that, you know, I try to keep God rooted, you know, in my life and rooted in my heart. So, again, I can be an example of what He wants me to be. So,
you know, Joey, I think the closer we are to God in our walk with Him, it allows us to see through all the influences in our life, to sort through all the noise and not let it get the best of us.
Yep.
You know, there's a lot of people yelling. But I think a question that we'd have to ask ourselves, to whom are we listening?
Yeah.
And I think that the more that we listen to God, study His Word, and allow God to speak to us through His Scriptures, through these devotions, through support that we have for one another. You know, I have people that send me uplifting scriptures and encouragement every day. And, you know, okay, so it takes 30 seconds or a minute or three. Not a huge commitment, you know, in the grand scheme of things, but it's such a powerful statement to my life that people care enough about me to do that. Whether it takes 2 minutes or 2 hours, it doesn't really matter. It's the thought that counts. And I'm just so thankful that I have so many people that care about me and love me and love me and my family. And I think it's I think it's important that we do what Denzel Washington said in his commencement speech. That's keep God first. Above everything else.
Yes.
Yep.
Above your spouse, above your spouse, above your kids, your grandkids, your job. Everything, God has to come first.
Yeah. A kind word, a kind deed can go a long, long way.
Amen.
Life. You may not think about it much, but to another person, it may mean the world to them. So. All right. Anybody else? All right, let us pray. Dear God, please help us to resist what's harmful and to discern what's good by resting in you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, here we are, Thursday, August 8th. The original date that Mary Jean and I were supposed to get married. but we had to move it up a week.
Oh my goodness.
Bless your heart.
Yeah. James 5:16 says, confess your sins to each other. Boy, that's one of those now the preacher's gone to meddling. cleansing confession. There is a man people hire as they're dying, paying him to show up at their funerals and reveal secrets that they never shared while they were alive. The man has interrupted eulogies. He's asked stunned officiants to sit down. When they start to object, he once stood to explain how the man in the casket had won the lotto, but never told a soul for decades, pretended to be a successful businessman. Multiple times, the hired man has confessed infidelity to a widowed spouse. One might question whether these actions were exploitative, or enacted in good faith. But what's obvious is people's hunger to be absolved of past sin. Having someone else confess for us, especially after we're dead, is a futile and risky way to deal with secrets. These stories, however, reveal a deep truth. We have a need to confess, to unburden ourselves. Confession cleanses us of those things that we've hidden and allowed to fester. Confess your sins to each other, James says, and pray for each other so that you may be healed. That's the full verse of 5:16. Confession releases us from burdens that bind us, freeing us to commune with God, praying with a heart open to Him, to our faith community. Confession enacts healing. James invites us to live an open life, confessing to God and those closest to us in the pains and failings we've attempted to bury. We don't have to carry these burdens alone. Confession is a gift to us. God uses it to cleanse our heart and set us free. That comes to us tonight from Wynn Collier. Okay, Joey and Jerry, what do y'all need to confess and to whom? And Jerry and Joey, what's holding you back?
Oh my goodness.
And I will, because I care about you, allow y'all to go first.
Thank you so much. Oh my gosh. Well, I know for me myself, you know, this has been a whirlwind of a week at work for me. We do this every single year, but around this time, we have about 200 or so incoming first year medical students come through our office to complete training that the School of Medicine requires for them. And that has just wrapped up today. Praise the Lord Almighty, I will say. You know, and it's a good, you know, interaction with the students, but just the stress of leading up to it, you know, like on Tuesday, our first day, we had two of our instructors that were supposed to be there, you know, last minute emergencies, you know, and I don't know, emergencies happen, but that left us like at the 11th hour scrambling, trying to find replacements for them, you know, because those are essential to be there to help. But I say all that to say, you know, some of my thoughts and words and actions may have not been what Jesus would have wanted me to say. So that's me right there this week. I'm thankful for His grace and His mercy and His love and forgiveness. So
I think the biggest thing that I have a problem with is convincing immediate family members that you don't come up with things to keep you from church on Sunday. You let church keep you from things.
Yeah.
And that's been a difficult story of my life. You try to lead an exemplary lifestyle, but and expect siblings and, well, of course, my siblings gone now and has been for several years, but offspring, I guess I could say, that look up and follow you in your footsteps.
Well, I'll just say that Mary Jean and I try to live a pretty open life. I don't know that we have any secrets from one another. She knows all the bad things about me, and I know all the bad things about her, and and yet we still love one another just as much. I don't know if there were any surprises after we got married, maybe one or two, maybe, I don't know, but we love each other. We trust each other. I jokingly tell people that, you know, I don't have any secrets. Anything you want to know, I'll tell you. And I pretty much have. I think, you know, I've made a lot of mistakes in my life. And I think that that gives me a good position to at least tell people what they shouldn't do.
It's true.
I don't know that I have the authority to tell people what they ought to do. That's their business. But hopefully I try to point them in the right direction. So, you know, I think the church, you know, when you go into the ministry, you have to go through a background check. You have to go sit before counseling a psychiatrist, and you got to talk about your past and all the skeletons in your closet. And I tell you that in today's world, there's no secrets out there. Everybody's pretty much an open book. I tell you that, I think it's a healthy thing for people to share with each other, especially when they're struggling.
That's the time that this leads to a word of encouragement.
I had a real good, somebody that really thinks of me at times when you're not really expecting them, and it really makes you feel good. You know, just the other night, of course, I talked to Jake quite a bit, but, you know, he knew I was going to be gone at night. And he calls me. He says, "Oh, did you get home?" "Yep, I'm home." "Okay, have you locked your door?" You know, for a person to care about you and think about you, about little things like that, that means a lot. Little is much when God's in it.
Amen.
That's true.
Somebody ought to write a song, Pat.
Yeah, David could be online and sing it, couldn't he?
Yeah, he could. I tell you, speaking of David, when I walked in there and saw him sitting by himself, made me I got worried.
Yeah.
About Kira, but everything was fine and good. But anyways.
We missed her song. Missed her song on Sunday night.
Yeah. She'll have to do it twice next month.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to pray this long prayer and finish this up. I think I just made Mary Jean laugh. Dear God, please help me practice confession. Amen.
Amen.
All right. I'm not going to go through and read our long list, but I just wonder, are any other mentions in the chat, Joey, for prayer requests?
I did not see any. Gaynell joined us so somewhere along the way here, so I don't know if she's still watching, but if she is, hello, hello, Gaynell. And we have a hi from Emma, Ruby, and Melissa, who is now on the screen with us. So hello again to you all. And I believe that is it. I don't see any other comments. So
okay.
And pray for my friend Leslie Simmons. Their house caught on fire the other night.
Oh, my goodness. That's terrible.
Yeah, the daughter was cooking chicken tenders and left the room to go to her bedroom. I guess she forgot about it, and the house caught on fire.
Okay. I got Leslie and her family on the prayer list.
And me too, you know.
Yeah.
Don't forget me, you know. I've had a bad 2 weeks this week, you know, since the wreck. It has really changed me completely about getting out driving now, you know. It has changed me completely. I don't get out much like I used to because it's changed, it changed me and I'm afraid because every time I get in the car, I'm afraid it's going to happen again, you know? And with my car still in the shop, my aunt loaned me her vehicle. So every time I get in her vehicle, I freak out because I watch in the rear mirror because that's where I was watching when this crazy nut hit me from behind because she wasn't paying attention and going too fast. And I'm afraid it's going to happen again. Like the other day when my aunt was here, I told her, I said, I don't want to get out as much as I used to because if I get out and it happens again, I might not come back home, you know? And I just get so panic now these days. My nerves I stay at home most of all the day long.
Well, Melissa, I would just tell you.
Here's a reminder for you right here.
God is in control.
God is in control.
God is in control. So I would just tell you, Melissa, don't freak out. Don't worry. Don't get upset. What I would recommend you do, that if you plan on going somewhere, first thing you do when you get out of bed is pray about it. Pray when you get in the car, pray as you're driving. Don't worry about the rearview mirror all the time, because then your eyes are not on the road. And just realize that Jesus is sitting there in the car with you.
I looked up on an accidents report of where likely the most accidents happen is at intersections and traffic lights, and I try to avoid those areas. So when I come to a stop sign, you know, because I wasn't at a stop sign when it happened. I was on a busy road, a two-lane road, and I just was turning to the right to go into So I had the right of way. He came up, he swerved me on my right hand, told his car, mine got, it was drivable home. But every time I come to a stop sign now or red light, I panic because I look at the rear mirror to see if those are people behind me. No. That's just, I have to go back roads sometimes just to get to where I need to go, but to avoid all that. So it's just nerve-wracking.
Oh, just remember that give it all to God and he'll take care of you.
Yes, yes.
And so just don't worry about it. Don't think about it. Just pray about it and just do the best job that you can do driving your vehicle, and just be alert and just watch the road, and God will take care of it.
Amen.
All right, y'all, we've made it till 8:30 again. It's been an enjoyable time. I thank you all for joining us. Melissa, thank you for joining us. Ms. Hazel, thank you for being with us tonight. And I'm thankful for Joey and Jerry helping me do these. Joey, every time you get that bottle, it looks like you're vaping.
I'm not. It's my cool little UAB water bottle. Go Blazers.
The way you're holding it, it looks like when people are vaping.
Yeah.
All I need now, I guess, is a little cloud of smoke. Like.
Yeah.
That's why I tried to do it off camera a while ago. So let's go.
Well, folks, thank you for tonight. Hope everybody has a good restful night and a good day tomorrow and Saturday. And hope everybody out there who may be watching has a great day at church. Hope you can join us at Whorton Bend, 10:30, Sunday morning, 9:15. Max Lucado study. You're never alone. Never Amen. Alone.
Emma's here.
That's
Good
right.
Night, everybody.
Well,
good night, everybody. They're
night.
Trying to chase me down.
Okay. Well, let's close with a word of prayer. Almighty God, I thank you for being with us tonight. Thank you for this opportunity to come together on social media and see each other and talk to one another. And thank you for all those that joined us on watching on Facebook. Lord, I ask you to be with all of us, all of our families. Go with us now and give us a good night's rest that we might awake refreshed in the morning, that we might be better servants for you, so that we can apply what we've learned in discussing these devotions tonight. Almighty God, we just lift up each name on our prayer list, especially those that are struggling, health issues, dealing with the loss of loved ones. Lord, we just ask that you would comfort them and be with them and help them to realize that they're never alone. Lord, we just give to you anyone who's dealing with health issues. Lord knows that every day we get a little older, and it seems like the health issues seem to stack up. But Lord, we know that you're the great physician. You know what's best. We ask for healing for those that are in your will. And Lord, we just ask that you just help us to deal with any struggles that we might have because of poor health. Lord, I just ask that you just give each one of us the strength, the courage, the desire to put you first in our lives, that we might live a blessed and happy life. Lord, we just love you and thank you for all things. And Lord, bless Mary Jean for sneezing and help us to seek your face more and more each day. Lord, we love you and thank you. And all these things we ask in the precious name of Jesus. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen.